This is a Thorium Energy Alliance conference. So it has thorium in the name, and you would think that we would be talking about thorium all the time. But think about all the talks that have been here. It's mostly about uranium, right? We should be talking about thorium because thorium can do something unique and special that uranium cannot do. All the uranium reactors I know, they run on uranium-235. And you know that little sliver, that orange little sliver there? That's uranium-235. It's very rare. So in reality, there's 1,000 times more thorium than there is uranium. We already do mining for other materials, and we get thorium out of the ground when we do mining for rare earth and gold and copper and shit. That thorium alone that we already get out of the ground today would be enough to power the entire electricity of the whole planet. We don't need to open one additional mine, but the problem is we don't have the machine that can take the energy out of that ball. And that's what we're trying to build, and I know a few others who are trying the same. The price for thorium is $50 per kilogram. We've already ordered tons of thorium, so I know this price because that's what we paid for it. If 1 kilogram of thorium, you can get 22 gigawatt hours of thermal energy out of that. The goal for Copenhagen Atomics is to build one reactor every day. But of course, we also need to deploy them, and deployment is a little bit more difficult. I would expect that in the beginning for a 1 gigawatt power plant, we will take 18 months to deploy that. And later on, when we sort of get things up to speed, we should be able to deploy in 6 months a 1 gigawatt power plant because it's not built on site. It's truly modular. It arrives on trucks. And then the price of energy for these type of reactors is between $20 and $40 per megawatt hour. You know that car factories, they can easily make 1,000 cars every day. Our reactors have less components than a modern car. The problem is not so much to mass manufacture these. The problem is to deploy one reactor every day. That's a difficult challenge to get approvals to deploy one reactor every day. We've divided our development into these 6 milestones. We started 10 years ago. We have developed unique pumps for molten salt reactors. We've also developed a method to purify salt, because if you purify the salt and get rid of moisture and oxygen and everything, you get less corrosion. And some people say, oh, corrosion is a big problem for molten salt reactors. I think we've solved that. We don't bother to run with expensive materials. We can use stainless steel 316 and run that for many years, no problems with corrosion. So we've spent a lot of time on technology for molten salt reactors. We're selling some of the technology to other players in the industry. The second milestone there is we're developing non-fission prototypes. So we've already built 2 reactors, full-scale reactors, the same size as our commercial reactor. And we're running those with non-radioactive materials, so basically FLINAC salt, in our workshop in Copenhagen. We heat it up with electricity and we pump the salt around and we do all kinds of tests with thermal expansion and thermal cycling and heat exchangers and all these things we need to test before we can go to a real reactor. And the first real reactor is a 1 megawatt test reactor that we plan to run in 2026. Our reactor has the onion core and it's using thorium as a blanket. That first test reactor, we're going to run it for 1 month and we're going to run it at 1 megawatt. So it's basically just a test. And the reason why we run it for a short amount of time and small power is then we can transport the things around on the roads afterwards. We would really like to be able to move it around, especially the fuel. But like I said, it's a full-scale reactor. It's the same reactor design as the commercial reactor. We've just not run it at full power. So as soon as we have that up and running, we will move towards the first commercial reactors. Once we have proven that the commercial reactors are working and they're providing energy and selling energy and they can run for a number of years, then we will start the mass manufacturing in the early 2030s. And I think we will go just directly to making 1 reactor every day. And of course, right now we're trying to get our heads around how do we actually deploy all those reactors. And then finally, the really, really, really big goal is milestone number 6, where we want to make a thorium breeder reactor in thermal spectrum. Last year, we moved into this new facility. It's 11,000 square meters, and we have 75 employees. And it's a really big facility where we can build and test many reactors. We plan to build the first 10 commercial reactors there. Once we've proven the first 10 commercial reactors, we're going to build an assembly line production. A couple of days ago, I went to the Gigafactory in Austin. It's a little bit like a Gigafactory. And I don't think we will place that in Denmark because Denmark is really good at R&D. We've shown that again and again for several hundred years. It is not very good at volume production. But we're looking for another country where we can put the mass manufacturing of reactors. a little bit about our reactor design. I talked about in the beginning that we want to make a machine that can convert thorium into energy very, very efficiently. We have the schematics of an onion core. Next to that, there's an insulation wall. That's because inside the 40-foot shipping container, there's a cold region and a hot region. The cold region is sort of blue and at room temperature. The hot region is a little bit orange and usually 600 degrees. And then you have a number of heat exchangers that takes the heat that is produced from the hot salt out to the customer. The heavy water we use as a moderator needs to be cooled all the time. Roughly 5% of the energy that is produced by the reactor goes into heat in the water, and we need to take that out. So there's a number of heat exchangers sending the water out for cooling. At the bottom, there's a number of tanks. So when we shut down the reactor, all of this liquid up in these heat exchangers and the reactor core will drain into the tanks at the bottom. Basically, we do that just by stopping the pumps. As soon as we stop the pumps, everything will drain down into the tanks. And then when we start the pumps again, it will start running. So basically, to shut down this reactor, you just cut the power to the box, then it will stop. The thick gray line around it, that is the third barrier. So we need three barriers between the radioactive salt and people outside. And the third barrier is half a meter thick steel wall to protect the reactor from what's coming from outside. But also if something happened inside the reactor, it will protect people outside. A little bit about the onion core. So it's roughly 2.3 meters in diameter, and it's mostly full of water. It's, of course, heavy water. Heavy water is a really, really good moderator. And then you have a thorium blanket. It encapsulates the whole reactor core. This way, we minimize the leakage neutrons. Most reactors, especially fast reactors, they have neutrons flying out of the core. Like some fast reactor designs have half of the neutrons flying out of the core. With this kind of thorium blanket, we can get neutron leakage down to 2%. No reactor has ever been this efficient. And of course, in the blanket, we breed uranium-233 from thorium. Some people say, oh, you extract protactinium. No, we don't extract protactinium. We extract all the different uranium species in the blanket, and then we put them into the fuel salt. And the fuel salt, of course, being the orange-colored channel in the middle, that is where the heat is produced. And of course, the heavy water is there to moderate or slow down the neutrons. So how can you have 600 degrees hot salt right next to cold water? Well, you need a little bit of insulation. We have roughly 1 inch of insulation between them. And that's enough because the majority of the heat in the water doesn't come from heat radiating from the hot channels to the cold channels. The vast majority, more than 90% of the heat in the water comes from slowing down the neutrons. We need to cool the water anyway. So we only need a little bit of insulation to make sure that the water doesn't boil. And of course, we have to cool the water all the time. So our reactor, if you look at a 1 gigawatt power plant, it would look something like this, an array of reactors in these cocoons. In this case, we would need 25 reactors for a 1 gigawatt plant and then some additional empty cocoons so that we can swap things around. The whole idea with this power plant is that no humans go inside this building for 50 years. It's running for 50 years. Of course, you can go in there if you want to, but we don't want to have humans mess up things. Remote control cranes, remote control forklifts, and then somebody from the operation room controls what's going on in there. That building produces heat, and then we transfer the heat over to some buffer tanks, and then you can see there's a line of steam generators, so if you want to make steam, you can run a steam turbine or use the steam for some industrial process. This is one of our test reactors that are now running in Copenhagen. When I say running, it's heated by electricity and it's pumping the salt around. It's not fission or chain reaction going on yet, but we're getting close to that point. Here's a picture from inside where you see the onion core and some of the pipes and the heat exchangers and the heaters and other pumps. The nuclear industry should become a commercial industry. Copenhagen Atomics will finance, build, own, and operate the reactors at a customer site. We believe most of our customers will be customers that make commodities, ammonia, aluminum, hydrogen, other things. And then we will operate our plant at their facility, but we will finance it, the capex up front, the capital cost of building it, and we will run it, and then we sell the heat to the customer on a long-term contract. The Copenhagen Atomics reactor is also capable of running on spent nuclear fuel. It's a little bit difficult to get approvals to get spent nuclear fuel and show that you can run on that. So we have postponed that a little bit into the 2030s to get up and running with that. In our reactor design, if you take spent fuel from a classical nuclear reactor, we can get 10 times more energy out of that fuel than what came out of it in the old reactor. And then we will store the fission products for the first, say, 50 or 100 years so that 90% of the radioactivity from the fission products has decayed away before we give the fission product back to the government or the state where the energy was produced. We still want to take the fission products and give it back to the country in which we're operating. And of course, they have to accept that. That's part of the deal. But I think it's much easier for a country to get fission products that are already 100 years old and have very little radioactivity left in them. And fission products only needs to be stored above ground for maybe 300 years in total before you don't have to protect them anymore. So it's a very different way of looking at nuclear waste than how we look at it today from spent nuclear fuel. I hope some of you have some questions.
What type of uranium fluoride are you going to use? Is it U-235?
We need a kickstarter fuel to get the reactor going, and that can be uranium-235 or it can be transuranics. We would prefer to use transuranics, but like I said, it's difficult to get your hands on that right now. So the first reactors are going to start on 5% enriched uranium, regular reactor-grade uranium.
You've got two isotopic separation things going on then. You've got a deuterium and you've got lithium for fluoride salt. Do you have isotopic separation suppliers?
Deuterium or heavy water is available from many different suppliers. You're from Canada. Canada is one of the biggest exporters of heavy water. So we expect to just be able to buy heavy water off of the market. You're also correct that in order for our reactors to work, as I described here, we need highly enriched lithium-7. It's not really available. You can get somewhat enriched lithium-7 from China and Russia, but that's not sustainable. So we have decided many years ago to start our own production of lithium-6 and lithium-7. Our goal is to make 5N or 99.999% pure lithium-7. It's up and running in small scale, but it's not kilogram or ton scale yet. It will be kilogram scale before the end of this year. Ton scale, we have to wait until next year. It is something we're developing, and we plan to also supply many of the other companies in the nuclear industry, including the fusion companies, with lithium-6 and lithium-7. And we're really, really proud that we developed this technology to such a high purity. But I mean, it's still hard work to get that up and running.
I shouldn't stand so close to you while you talk about lithium-7 because the assassin.
Hi, I had a question about long-term goal of the waste burner. I'm curious about this LIBS system for measuring the isotope composition. That's going to have some kind of optical fiber to separate out the high radiation from the measuring instruments. What happens to that fiber in the high radiation environment?
That's a really good question. So fibers doesn't like radioactivity like gammas and neutrons. So they're going to wear out. And that's one of the problems we haven't really solved. And to be honest, I mean, we have worked on LIBS. We don't work very hard on that right now because we don't need it for the 1 megawatt test reactor. And right now we're focusing all our capital on getting the 1 megawatt test reactor up and running. You also know the MSRE ran for 5 years. It didn't have LIBS. So clearly you can run reactors without LIBS. It would be great to have it, but right now we've decided to sort of put less effort on that until we have the test reactor running. But you're absolutely right. There are some difficult problems to solve.
I was wondering if you could clarify the length of how long the cores will run. I thought I heard 50 years.
We will ask for a license for 50 years for the whole power plant. But the reactors itself, the sort of the vessel, the pumps, the heat exchangers, will not last for 50 years. We expect in the beginning that they will last for roughly 5 years. So we will replace those parts every 5 years. But I mean, the whole power plant will last for a long time. And the expensive things like heavy water, lithium-7, all the fuel salt, the thorium fuel salt and the thorium blanket salt and the fuel salt will last for 50 years. So the majority of the CapEx is there for 50 years. But some of the pumps, we can make those last 50 years in the beginning at least.
I was wondering if you might be able to let us know a bit about the regulatory framework and if you figured out a country where you can do your first fission test.
We've talked to regulators in many countries. As somebody said also before, regulators need education about molten salt reactors. There's very, very few people who work for a regulator in one country or the other that have enough information about a molten salt reactor to be able to go through an approval process. So first, there's an education step. I think we are still in that loop. We're talking to a number of European countries and also a few countries outside. We're currently not talking to the NRC. We want to do the approval process for the 1 megawatt test reactor in several different countries because there might be some roadblocks in one country or the other. There's a roadblock we can continue in some of the other countries. It's still a lot of uncertainty in relation to approvals in many different countries. And in some countries, we have almost given up. But it is really tough. And there's been people also here who asked me today, what is the biggest problem for molten salt reactors or thorium energy? It's definitely that this regulatory approval, it's a big hurdle. And nobody seems to be able to give us how long will it take? What will it cost? And every time you talk to an investor, there's actually many, many, many investors who want to invest in this new area of technology because they realize that energy is really, really important for society. But we have hundreds of investors that we have lost because we go into a dialogue with them and sign all the papers and we give them all the details. And then they want to know how long would that approval take for the test reactor and what is it going to cost. Been able to invite some of them to meetings with the regulator. And after they've been there, they just run out of the door. They don't want to invest anymore. They say, you call me in 10 years once you have commercial reactors running, then I'll come back and invest. It is a really, really big hurdle for the nuclear industry, not only for us, but for everyone. And, I mean, even for light water reactors. It's crazy why it should be this difficult.
Thank you, Thomas. Thank you very much.